In other words, over millennia, the connection went from available to everyone all the time to ever more tenuous, finally faded out entirely. It's even more complicated than that, because surely people would have, as they saw this happening, make attempts to preserve the mushroom. And in a world without refrigeration, the only effective way to do this is preservation in honey. You can dry mushrooms, but in a world without hermetically sealed peanut butter jars, drying is a very short-term strategy for preservation. The only thing which will really work is preservation in honey. The problem there is that honey itself, especially Aboriginal honeys, which have a lot more water in them than what you get in those little plastic bears at the AMP. Aboriginal honeys are very runny, and so what do? They themselves have the capacity for turning into a psychoactive substance, alcohol. But alcohol promotes a completely different set of cultural values and attitudes than psilocybin. Psilocybin is a boundary-dissolving hallucinogen. Mead alcohol gives an enhanced sense of verbal acuity in the presence of lowered sensitivity to social cues. In other words, one can make an ass of oneself. But now I want to backtrack for a minute. I will return to this thing about the loss of the mushroom, but there's something that I want to go over with you that's really important in all this to me. And that is, this isn't simply the story of how an intoxicant promoted consciousness, and then we fell into history by losing that intoxicant and went on to other intoxicants with consequences to be evaluated. It's that, but it's more, because psilocybin had a very, very peculiar effect over and above what I've mentioned so far, and it is this over and above effect that makes my theory so controversial and so and academics, I think, so phobic of it, because it rips open a whole can of worms, and this is the problem. All primates, clear back to squirrel monkeys and old world monkeys, all primates form dominance hierarchies. This means that the sharp-fanged, hard-bodied young males control everybody else. The women, the elderly, the sick, the children, homosexuals, everybody finds their place somewhere in this dominance hierarchy run by these dominant alpha males. We are no different. We also, as we sit here this evening, operate under this kind of a social organization. I mean, we complain about it, we analyze it, we are aware of it, but we live under it. It's how it is. So here is my suggestion that what psilocybin did was it changed behavior. It interfered with primate behavior. Specifically, it interfered with this tendency to form monogamous pairs and dominance hierarchies. And so the ordinary tendency of the primates to organize themselves that way was interrupted, medicated out of existence, if you like, vaccinated against, if you like, by the presence of psilocybin in the diet. And this overemphasizing or chemical accentuation of sexuality occasioned by the arousal of the psilocybin was sufficient to dissolve the ordinary tendency toward monogamy and replace it with an orgiastic sexual style, or they coexisted simultaneously. I mean, who knows? We weren't there. It's sort of the way I imagine it is that at every new and full moon, there were group mushroom parties, which basically simply got out of hand regularly. And so the monogamous pair bond would be under pressure, if not completely eliminated. Many cultures have this, even to this day. I mean, in a sense, Mardi Gras is a festival where the rules are dissolved, and nobody is supposed to go to their spouse the Monday after and say, you know, was that you I saw dressed as Marie Antoinette? And because, you know, the rules are, there is permission to break the rules, and many societies do this. The result of an orgiastic style like that is men cannot trace lines of male paternity. And so there is a tremendous social glue, a tremendous force for the cohesion of community. Men don't then think in terms of my children. They think in terms of our children, the children of the group. And under the aegis of this group, this polymorphic sexual style, group child care and extended family rearing, we produced everything that we think of as human, that we value. Our art, our music, our philosophy, our sense of each other's worth, body painting, tattooing, piercing, all the accoutrements that distinguish us from animal existence were put in place when we had a different kind of mind than we have now. We didn't have a mind that favored role specialization and male dominance and anxiety over female sexual activity related to feelings of male ownership. That all came later. We became human beings in this other world of values and psychological attitudes. Problem is that, as I say, the mushroom faded. But by the time it had faded, we were no longer the wordless symbiotes of cattle, the barely sentient hunters of the African plain. By the time we were finished with the mushrooms, we had language, we had social institutions, but what we began to lose was, you know, you can get as wet-eyed as you want about it, but respect for each other, a sense of each other's individuality, a sense of love, a sense of community. And it must have been, though it happened over a long period of time, very much like what we're living through now, a sense that people are, you know, no damn good and getting worse. A sense that, you know, why can't we be as we once were? Where is our sense of each other? Where is our ability to care for each other? So forth and so on. I wrote a book called Food of the Gods, in which I tell this story in the first third of the book that I've just told you. And then I show that what history is essentially is a careening, out of control effort to find our way back to this state of primordial balance. One of the things that marks us as humans that is unique is our obsessions with drugs, our ability to addict. We addict not only to substances, we addict to each other, we addict to ideologies, Marxism, Christianity, skinkism as practiced in Washington, whatever. And we addict to each other. You know, I mean, I am a romantic with the best of them, but I can't help noticing that a broken heart and heroin withdrawal show very similar presentations. Really. Insomnia, sweating, sense of diminished self-esteem, hysteria, it's very, very similar. A psychologist looking at a person with an addictive syndrome will say, well, you were damaged in childhood. There is some trauma there that you're trying to compensate. Well, I'm not that keen on all this psychologizing, but I do think that we could apply this model to ourselves on a grand scale. We were essentially torn from the Gaian womb, thrust into the birth canal of history, and expelled sometime around the fall of the Roman Empire into the cold, hard world of modern science, existentialism, and all the rest of it. And we have searched the planet for substances which would assuage our sense of pain. And there are things out there, you know, alcohol, the whole morphine family, so forth and so on. But these things always have consequences. There's a price to be paid. The very knowledge of psilocybin was lost to the entire planet, except for some tribes in the Mexican mountains, for several millennia, until Valentina and Gordon Wasson went in the early 1950s and found these mushrooms and brought them out, and then Albert Hofmann, who had earlier discovered LSD, synthesized the compound and made it available. That was 55. Well, by 66, all human research with these things had been forbidden. It's not that science mowed this field and moved on. It's that science has never really been here. We haven't looked at the implications of diet on early human evolution. We don't have a theory for the evolution of consciousness of any consequence. And yet, you know, the factors I've laid out for you, increased visual acuity, an impact on sexual and social behaviors, a triggering of glossolalia-like phenomena in the presence of a boundary-dissolving psychedelic experience, these are catalysts sufficiently dramatic that, inculcated into a cultural style, I think they explain a great deal about where we came from and who we are. Now, the irony of all of this is that we live in a society that has made practically any discussion of this illegal. Certainly, if I were to end this lecture by handing out doses of psilocybin, I would be gently taken by the elbow and led away forever. The Western mind is particularly phobic of this subject. I mean, we have bent our laws so that people can jump out of airplanes in the pursuit of thrills, so that they can bungee cord off major highway bridges and freeway overpasses. So concerned are we to fulfill society's need for thrills. But this is something else. It provokes all kinds of alarmed reactions, and perhaps you believe unfairly. I think that when you examine the situation, it's possible to understand very clearly why this is such a social issue. Because what these things do, if you look, and now I'm slightly broadening my wrap to include other psychedelics besides psilocybin, but psilocybin is certainly true in all cases. What these things do, if you had to generalize 100,000 psychedelic experiences, the ones where people thought they were God, the ones where people had to be taken to the ER room and have their stomach pumps, all of them, if you generalized, what these substances do is they dissolve boundaries.